Okay, thanks everyone for coming to our talks today. I want to talk about Polyglot Native, another exciting part of the GraalVM effort that we do in Oracle Labs. I am Christian Wimmer. I'm based here in the Oracle headquarters in Redwood Shores. You already know that slide. Please try our stuff, challenge us, benchmark us, give us feedback, but don't run home and buy Oracle stock just because you like this talk. I want to talk about Polyglot Native today. What do we mean by Polyglot Native? Well, long time ago, there was this thing called Java started with the nice slogan, write once, run anywhere. And the main advantage that Java gave and still gives is you have this Java VM abstraction, we have bytecode, you have class files, and it gives you a very big ecosystem that goes far beyond Java and many other languages built on that. So there is Scala, there is Kotlin. They all run nicely into this ecosystem. And if you look at the homepages, both Scala and Kotlin say, well, one of the most important features is 100% compatibility with Java code. So you can have Java code, you can have Kotlin code, you can have Scala code. You mix all together, it all runs together, it all integrates. But there are a few things that are not so great on this system. And some people really need that. Some people really want startup performance. Some people really want the best possible memory footprint. Some people really want complete and best possible seamless C integration. That's something that the Java VM ecosystem does not give you. So what are people doing, the Kotlin and the Scala people? They say, well, yes, normally our language runs nicely on the Hotspot VM, but we also have this separate backend. So we have Kotlin Native that does native compilation of Kotlin, there's Scala Native that does native compilation of Scala, but you lose more or less all your benefits. On the Kotlin Native homepage, the word Java does not exist. And the Scala Native homepage says, well, Scala supports a subset of the JDK libraries re-implemented in Scala, and you see all the nasty words here, subset, re-implementation, and JDK, which means your Java library does not run on Scala Native. For example, the Netty library, everyone uses Netty in the Java ecosystem to do server-like stuff, web hosting, HTTP-like stuff. It just does not work on Scala Native. What we are trying to do with Polyglot Native is we take Java bytecodes as the starting point and do ahead-of-time compilation of this Java bytecodes, which means we take bytecodes without looking at the language they come from. It does not matter if it's Java, Kotlin, or Scala. We ahead-of-time compile the Java bytecodes to native code. We can then, since we have native code, we can do all the good thing with C code integration. So you get good startup performance, you get good memory footprint, you get good C integration. Of course, there's always one catch, and the only thing that we cannot do in this system is dynamic class loading of new Java classes, which means at the time when you do the ahead of time compilation, you have to know which Java classes, which Kotlin code, which Scala code goes into your executable. So that's part of our overall GraalVM architecture, where you can run the bytecode languages, Java, Kotlin, Scala, then our Truffle framework that gives you JavaScript, Ruby, and R, and in the last talk we had Sulong with C and C++, so you can run all of that either on the Java Hotspot VM, then you get the normal Java semantic, or you can run it on our Polyglot Native infrastructure, which is then the underlying substrate VM, and you get native performance and native startup. So this talk focuses on this right-hand side of the slide on substrate VM in contrast to the Java Hotspot VM. You can download our stuff on the Oracle Technical Network. Just search for OTN Graal. We have publications and tutorials that you can look at if you want to know more about Graal and Truffle. We have the open source code on GitHub, so there's the GraalVM organization and the Graal repository. if you want to look at that. Substrate VM is the foundation of our polyglot native effort, and we want to do a complete ahead of time compilation of Java classes and bytecodes, which means you have to know all your classes that you want to ahead of time compile, which means that's your application, that's the JDK, these are all the libraries that you use, that's also the substrate VM source code, which is all written in Java. So we have a bunch of Java classes, and we assume we have a closed world of these Java classes with no dynamic class loading. So we can run a very aggressive static analysis, a points to analysis, that finds on a very fine-grained level all the fields, all the methods, all the classes that are reachable. And once we know everything that's reachable, we can ahead of time compile all these reachable parts into a standard executable or shared library. So on Linux, you get the standard ELF executable. On macOS, you get the MachO binary. The ahead of time compilation is, of course, done with the Graal compiler, which is a very customizable compiler. So we just customize it to do ahead of time compilation instead of just in time compilation. We also use Graal itself as a static analysis framework. So because Graal and this whole process of the native image generation runs on the hotspot VM, and we use Graal and the hosting Java VM to do all the class loading, to do all the parsing of the class files, to access the bytecodes, access the Java type hierarchy, and that way to implement our static points to analysis, we didn't have to reinvent the wheel, so we could reuse more or less all of that infrastructure. And then, yeah, we know, we identify all the methods that are reachable from the root method, which is the entry point into your application. We identify all the types that are assigned to a field. We identify all instantiated types. And then we run a fixed point analysis. How does that work? I have a little example of a type flow graph. So on the left-hand side, you have a simple method foo that calls a method to allocate something and store the result of the allocation in the field f. And we are allocating a point instance, which is just, as you can assume, any a Java class. And then we call a method bar that calls f.hashcode on this point instance. And on the right-hand side, you see this type flow graph that we construct out of this source code. So all the gray boxes are more or less method boundaries. But the type propagation itself doesn't really need to worry about method boundaries. It really follows the flow of types. The source of types are, of course, object allocations. So the allocation of a new point instance is a source of an exact type point. So we know the allocation new point returns a point instance and guarantees nothing else. So when we have then a put field node in this type flow graph, we know that we store a point instance into the field f. So this little green box on the side is the type state of the field f. And when we propagate the type down, now we know that the field f can contain the type point. In the method bar, we load this field f, so the node for the get field of the field f now returns a type point because we know we store the type point into the field f. And we propagate it down to the object in the method bar where we do in the method bar. And then we call the method hashcode. And we know the method object.hashcode is, of course, a virtual method call. But since the only type that can reach this method invocation is the type point, we know that only the method point.hashcode is here is actually reachable. So at this point, we don't have to compile in all the possible hashcode methods that the JDK has, which are thousands, because every class more or less has a separate implementation of hashcode. In that case, we know we only need to compile in the method point.hashcode, because only this method is reachable. In the simplest case, and that's sufficient for us, this points to analysis is context insensitive, which means if you have some code somewhere else that stores a string, into the field F, because as you can see in the example, the field F is defined of type object, so we can, of course, assign a string to it. So if you have some code somewhere else that stores a string into the field F, then this new string, string type is stored into F, it's propagated down to the get field and to the virtual call site. And now we also have to say that this virtual call can reach the method string.hashcode. That's something that, because we are context insensitive, we don't really store any inter-method context information, so we are a little bit conservative here. But now we have two hashcode methods in our native executable, but still only two, and not all the thousands that the JDK might have. And this is a fixed point analysis. We know all the sources. We built the type flow graph for the whole application. And as you can see, the snapshot between these two slides, when you propagate types down in the graph, the reachable graph might actually grow, because you say, well, you put a new type into the system, you have a new virtual call, so you have a new method that gets reachable, and it's an iterative process. But at some point, you reach a fixed point, so you have the maximum exact type state of all variables that deal with objects, and then your analysis terminates, and we know everything that is possibly reachable. And then we take all these methods ahead of time, compile them, and run them. How does that work in practice? I can give you a little demo that's a little bit more than Hello World. So what I'm doing here is you can download the GraalVM binary from the Oracle Technical Network. So current version is 0.26. And I did that and put it in my environment variable GraalVM home. And I run the native image tool that's part of this GraalVM binary. I say, well, the class path of what I want to have reachable, possibly reachable, is my tools.jar. And my main entry point that I want to AOT compile is in this tools.jar, the javac.main method. I want to create an executable named javac. And it's all static compilation, so we don't have jar files available at runtime. So we also need to tell this native image tool that, yeah, we want to use some of the resource bundles that are put into the, that are in the jar file normally, and we want to put these resource bundles into the executable. And when I run that, it takes about 30 seconds, so I don't want to do that right now. Then you get the native executable named javac, and I can run that with a hello world.java. And you can compile hello world.java in about 30 milliseconds here on my machine, which is much faster, of course, compared when you run a javac normally on the hotspot VM, because then it takes about 400 milliseconds. Because you have to start up the whole Java VM, you have to load all the classes and do all the initialization. Of course, I already said that there are some limitations, and actually, for javac, the limitations really matter, because actually javac would really like to do dynamic class loading to possibly load annotation processors. That's something that we cannot do, because loading an annotation processor, that would mean loading new bytecodes, and there are no bytecodes, there is no class loading in the executable, so that's why I explicitly disable annotation processing here. So there is always a downside, of course. But if you're just interested in very fast startup of your Java application, that's something that we can give you. In our whole GraalVM ecosystem, we have, we already heard in the last talk, the Truffle language implementation framework, where we have language implementations like JavaScript, Ruby, and R. And that means we have an implementation of a JavaScript VM written completely in Java. And we can use this native image tool to make a native binary executable for JavaScript. And this binary is fortunately already shipped with the GraalVM, so you don't even have to build that yourself. So we can try that out. So let's first look at what do you get in terms of JavaScript startup from a real native VM like V8? So the V8 standalone binary is called D8. So when I call that and run it with a Hello World or Java script, it starts up in a couple of milliseconds. When I want to run the Nashorn JavaScript VM, which is a JavaScript VM written in Java that does dynamic bytecode generation, so it needs to first initialize the Java hotspot VM, it needs to load the Nashorn jar file, it needs to pass the JavaScript file, create bytecodes for that. All takes quite a good bit of time. So it takes about half a second to run the Hello World JavaScript here. But when I take our Truffle JavaScript engine, which is also completely written in Java, but ahead of time compiled with this native image tool, then you get again the same startup performance that you are used to from a really heavily customized C++ VM like JavaScript, like V8. And even though we do all this native image generation and ahead of time compilation, we must not sacrifice peak performance, of course. So if I run things like the Octane Richards benchmark on the V8 VM, and I run it in total here for 4 seconds warm up, 4 seconds execution time, you see, well, V8 gives you a Richards score of 35,000. Nashorn, sorry, that was the one. Wrong command line. Needs to do all this bytecode generation, then just in time compiles the bytecodes with the hotspot server compiler. But Java bytecodes don't really match the execution semantics of JavaScript, so you get a couple of X slowdown compared to V8 for JavaScript. And if I run our native binary with the Richards benchmark, then takes out the usual 8 seconds. You see that our peak performance is more or less exactly the same as the peak performance of the V8 JavaScript VM. So what do you get from a Polyglot Native and the whole Truffle ecosystem? You get the same startup as a native JavaScript VM. You get the same peak performance as a native JavaScript VM. But as we saw in the last talk, you get the additional benefits of all this nice language integration. And I have a demo of that at the end of our talk, too. And if you look at the slides, all the things that I did right now are also in the slide sets. Since we already now have a nice native executable for your Java application, what we can do now is we can do a very lightweight, very simple and fast Java C integration. So you can use our Polyglot Native interface to call to C without any overhead that JNI normally imposes and without any restrictions of JNI. And of course, you can, from your new Java code, you can also call existing Java code like all native existing Java libraries. But existing Java code then, of course, cannot do the C integration, because if you have Java code that also needs to run on the hotspot VM, that's something you cannot do. So the classes and the code that I show you in the next slides, that's only going to work when you run on this Polyglot Native infrastructure. So this code does not run on the Java hotspot VM. There's, to simplify the integration, what we did is we more or less flipped around the worlds, because in the Java Native interface, what you have to do is you have to write custom C code to integrate your C code with Java code. So you need to write all these nasty C code wrappers that no one wants to write. And I know Project Panama is going to get rid of that, but until that ships, well, there's, you don't have that in the product yet on the hotspot VM. But with the Java Native interface, that means your C code knows about Java types, and you pass Java objects to the C code using handles, and then you do stuff with this handle usually on the C code side. In our integration, you instead write custom Java code, and you directly access C data structures from Java code. and I'll show you in a minute how that looks like. We have the same restriction as the hotspot VM, of course. If you have managed Java objects that are garbage collected, you cannot access these things from C code. So we still have this strict separation between Java objects and C objects. We never allow C code to directly access Java objects because that would mean we have restrictions in when and how we can do a garbage collection. With the small exception that on the Java side, you can say, well, I want to pin an object, like you have a large byte array, you say, please pin it, that tells the garbage collector to not move this object until you release the pin, and then you can pass out the pointer into the middle of a byte array. But so you can do that, but usually it's not the preferred thing to do. What we need in this Java C interface is we need a raw pointer type in Java. And of course, you could use a primitive long value to represent C pointers, but from a type safety point of view, that's not really good. So what we introduce is a Java interface hierarchy for that. With the there's a basic interface called WordBase, which more or less represents an unboxed raw C word-sized value. And there are sub-interfaces like pointer, that's a C void star pointer, where you then can do memory access. And this, all these usages of the word type are specially intrinsified by the Graal compiler when you do the AOT compilation, and they are more or less then mapped to a raw pointer type. That's definitely nothing that we invented for our infrastructure. So Maxine VM had exactly the same infrastructure. The Jaix RVM had exactly the same infrastructure. So that's more or less has been around for a long time. And I think it's a very proven technology that's known to work. And based on that, we implemented some annotations. And Graal has special knowledge of these annotations to do the C integration. In this example, what I want to do is I want to call the C function in the libc clock get time from Java code. So what I do is I define a Java signature and a Java prototype for this function. Since this is a C function, I don't want to provide any Java code, of course, so I declare it as Java native. To make the Java C compiler happy. But the important thing is I annotate it with our annotation, say, at C function, which tells our infrastructure to say, well, that's not a GNI call. That's actually a direct call of a C function. And primitive types, well, you can just pass. But the second parameter of clock get time is a C structure. And in order to use a C structure, you have to import the C structure to Java 2, which we do here in this with the help of an interface. So we say, well, we implement, we import the struct C struct time spec, and on the C side, it has two struct members, tvsec and tvnsec. These are all long types. And these annotations again tell our infrastructure that, no, this is not the Java interface, this is actually a C structure. So these at C struct and at C field annotations are the markers for that are then triggering the intrinsification. So even though it looks like an interface, it feels like an interface when you write your Java code, so it gives you a really nice experience when you write the Java code. But when we call this method, then the call to this tvsec method is never a method call. It really is always a direct memory read. So there's never any memory call, any method call overhead for this property accesses. For the parameter clock ID, C defines a couple of constants that we can pass as parameters. We also import these constants to Java and say, well, there's a C constant called clock monotonic, and we don't know the value. We don't care about the value because it's defined somewhere in the libc header file, so we don't need to provide a value, but we need to tell our infrastructure to say, well, please use the value from the C side. And again, it looks like a method here, but a call to this method is intrinsified to the real constant value from the C side. So there's no method call overhead here. Where do we get things like the field offsets? Where do we get this value of clock monotonic? Well, we need to look at the header files, so you also need to tell our infrastructure that in this class time, everything that we define here comes from the file time.h. So here we say, when resolving field offsets, when resolving the constants, please look at time.h and import the values from this header file. Now I have the C function in my Java world. So what I can do is I can call it here. So I have my C struct. And when calling this clock get time on the C side, you can pass, of course, a malloc piece of memory. But since you don't want to have a malloc-free overhead, you want to stack allocate the C structure, you can do that too. You say, well, please give me a stack allocated structure that has the size of a time spec. It's stored, the pointer to this stack memory is stored in this variable. We pass this variable to the C function. We pass the value of clock monotonic as the first parameter. And here, that's our call from Java to C. And then we access the field values here. So that's how you get from Java to C. How do you do the other direction? How do you get from C to Java? We can say, well, we have a Java method time here that we want to expose to existing C code, and we want to call it from C code. So we say, well, this function is marked as an entry point with the exported symbol name graal time Java. So you can call this function with the C calling convention from the C side. And then what we do in this method is we call the time, we get the return value as a string here, we convert the Java string back to a C string that we store in the provided buffer, and we return the filled buffer. The filled buffer is then used by the C side. How do you do that all from, how do you call it from C? So that's actually the main method of my little demo. So it's a normal C main method that here calls the Java function with normal buffer and the size of the buffer. You need to do a little boilerplate to initialize all the Java level data structures. So we use this very similar API to the people are familiar with the embedding API of V8 to embed JavaScript into native applications. We more or less have very similar API. You say, please create me an isolate, which means create me a new instance of a Java heap that I want to operate on, and attach the current thread to it, so I can now have a Java heap that I can operate on to allocate my Java strings. I have my current thread attached, so I can actually call from C to Java, and the Java VM knows about my thread. And then I call the Java function. For performance reasons, I pass in directly the thread pointer, which is more or less used in the context switch from C to Java. Remember that I said we have managed objects, of course, on the Java side, which means that the Java VM occasionally wants to garbage collect, which means the Java VM needs to stop all threads that are currently in Java code. And this transition from C to Java and Java to C is done with the help of this thread pointer. So you have a few additional memory loads and stores in the transition code, but nothing really heavyweight. And then I'm back in Java, in C here, and I can print out my buffer. I'm a good citizen, and I actually shut down the Java side again before exiting. Since I'm exiting the process anyway here, I wouldn't need to do that, because if I exit my process, then everything is gone anyway and discarded by the operating system. So you see I have a little application here that starts out in C. It goes to Java code. It goes from Java code back to C code, and then the whole round trip back. Now, let's run that. So I compile all my Java code. Then I run this native image tool. With the class path of my Java classes. This time I say, well, I want the shared library out of with the name libtimetest. So I run the native image tool. Which does all the AOT compilation. So you see It first does the static analysis and took a few seconds for the static analysis, took a few seconds for the AOT compilation. So what I have now is I have should have a lib time test. No, not now. Does it not exist? Oh, I think I have a. Sorry, where did this character come from? To wait 15 seconds again. So now we have a shared library that contains all the Java code. Currently, we haven't done much effort in minimizing the size of this shared library, so it's a couple of megabytes, but there's a lot of room for improvement here, but the problem is as soon as you pull in one thing from the JDK, which of course we do because we have the whole runtime system written in Java, then you actually pull in quite a bit of the JDK, like the whole system out, print line stuff, character conversion stuff. You saw that we convert the Java string back to the C string, which pulls in all the char set conversion, all the Unicode stuff. So the things add up a little bit. So now I have to compile my little C launcher. And now I should be able to call my time launcher. And it prints out the current time in the exactly the same format that I had before. And obviously, that whole thing runs in a couple of milliseconds because everything is AOT compiled. So what I do now when I run this is I start C code, I go to Java code, I go back to C code, and print the result in C code. And yes, it really is a normal C executable, so I can debug that, I can set the breakpoint in clock get time, and I can run that, and I'm going to stop here, and I have a backtrace that says, well, I'm in C clock get time, it was called from time test.time, which is my Java code, it's in time test.java in line 12, and we have our second Java method with the entry point, and then we have our C main method. You see, the AOT compilation really gives you something that native tools like GDB, VTune just see as the same way as it comes from GDB. Now let's go polyglot, since the talk is called Polyglot Native. I have here the code written in Java, but people don't want to write in Java, of course. We have some people in the room. Some people want to write in Kotlin or in Scala. I decided to go to Kotlin because usually there are a few more Kotlin people than Scala people in the room. So I converted exactly the same stack code from Java to Kotlin. So I allocate a C stack value. I call time clock get time from Kotlin to do something a little bit different and to also motivate why use Kotlin. Well, there is a nice JSON library in Kotlin where I can, with this one-liner here, instead of returning my custom formatted string, I can actually return a valid JSON representation of the second and the nanosecond. And then I can return the thing in the buffer again. So I have now a Kotlin function annotated with exactly the same annotation. So now my Kotlin function is the entry point. And it's named graal time Kotlin. So I have to change my code here and call the graal time Kotlin function. And need to compile all of that. So I run native image now. Since I'm using Kotlin, obviously I have to put the Kotlin standard library on the class path too. I need to put my JSON library on the class path. But all in all, otherwise not much changes. So I again have now my updated leap time test. I need to recompile my C code. Why doesn't it work? What did I do wrong? Interesting. Oh, I didn't compile the Kotlin code, did I? I should have compiled my Kotlin code. That would have helped. Yeah. Now I have my Kotlin code compiled. So actually, that means my my native image generation didn't really put anything in there. Well, it put since the class file from the Java world was still there, of course, it put still the Java entry point into the image, but not the Kotlin entry point. Now it also put the Kotlin entry point in. I can compile that, and now it works. And now we can run that again. You see, we really run the Kotlin code, we get the JSON output, so everything worked, and it still runs in a few milliseconds. So what do we have now? Now we have C code calling Kotlin code running a native Kotlin library. I didn't touch any of that. The Kotlin code calls back to C to get the time, all works. What else can we do? Well, we also want to leverage existing Java libraries, and one of the frequently used Java libraries, especially when looking at cloud stuff and software as a service, function as a service stuff, is you want to use Netty as a Java library to receive incoming network requests. So what I also did is I wrote a more or less minimal integration of a Netty HTTP server that calls my time function. So that's copy and paste it from the Netty homepage, how to start an HTTP server here. So you have an initializer and you have a handler. And in my HTTP handler, I call my my Kotlin function to get the time here. And I return that in an HTTP response. So you can look at the detail if you want to, but it really is boilerplate code here at the top. I call my function, I return this JSON code. And I wrote a little C launcher that does the same thing as before. It starts, initializes all the Java code, calls this Netty function. So you see, I don't have a Java main function. I again have actually a C entry point function here to as the main entry point, which I call here. And so here I start up my Netty server. And then on the C side, I do a socket request. So I and print it out. So what happens here, as soon as we see this print here, is we started up a complete Netty server on the Java side. We did a complete HTTP round trip on localhost, and we print the output. And when I already built and compiled everything to save some time here. So if we run this Netty launcher, you can see I get the same JSON output. Now it's an HTTP request, so I also get the HTTP header that I printed here. And I did the whole thing. I started up Netty. I did a whole HTTP round trip in 20 milliseconds. And that's all in the slides, if you're interested. So to summarize, that's again a picture of our whole GraalVM infrastructure, where we have Truffle with the different languages. And you can run that on the Hotspot VM and to leverage all the nice garbage collectors, the nice high performance multi-threaded system that Hotspot gives you. So if you have a JavaScript or R application that says, well, I want to run on terabytes of heap, I have hours long jobs, then you would run it on the Hotspot VM. If you say, well, I have all these languages, I have my C code, and I actually want to run very short running, function as a service kind of stuff, scripting applications, command line tools. Then you run the whole stack on the Substrate VM, and you get the excellent startup and the good memory footprint. So I have one last demo, more or less, of the our Truffle infrastructure. We have JavaScript support, we have R support, we have Node.js support. So what I have here is I have a little JavaScript file that does that's a Node.js application. So for those of you who know Node.js, that's the magic line here that starts up a Node.js server that listens on port 3000 and then waits for a request. And what I do in my Node.js request is I call from Node.js to the JDK to do big integer arithmetic. Java usually, JavaScript only has double as the number type, so when you want to have arbitrary precision in JavaScript, well, you can use a very expensive, very complicated JavaScript library to do that, or you can just call the JDK a big integer. You can call any Java code that you have written, so if you have your own Java library, you can call it too. But even better, if you say, well, I want to call R code now, so you create an R vector with 1,000 elements, and I'm printing an element of an R vector here. Or even more fancy stuff, you can say, well, I have R code here that defines some function and creates an R plot and plots this function. So I start up this Node.js server. So it's now listening on port 3000. Initializing R usually takes a little bit because it needs to do all this R package loading, so R is not known for fast startup. But what we will see now is, well, we did our big integer arithmetic, we called our custom Java code, and we did an R plot from our Node.js application and put our R plot back in the browser. And that's more or less what this whole GraalVM infrastructure gives you. With that, that's all that I wanted to talk about. Thanks for your attention, and I'm happy to answer all sorts of questions. I think we are mostly out of time here, so I would suggest that you hold your question for one more minute, because we actually have a Graal Truffle workshop lined up. So if you have questions, then you can stay for that. And we have an hour to answer all your questions there. So if that's okay, then I say thanks for your time.